here, and then he walked by. So has everyone had a chance to take a look through the budget?
Yes.
So Katie, Bob, when you want to take us through it?
Sure, well, I'll start off and then I'll hand it off to Katie. Just my usual opening statement, reminding the board that this is a draft. It's very much a work in progress. There are adjustments that still need to be made. We're going to be talking a little bit about your insurance, that costs that came in yesterday. So we've got a little bit of an update there. We've got special education costs that are being adjusted. I had a meeting with Mary Nash, and I think we clarified some of our billing, and hopefully that's stabilized what we're doing moving forward. We've got the tuition with Marshwood. We had some questions, and during the regular meeting, I'm going to be going into that a little bit, just kind of clarifying that. So I guess my opening statement just is that, it's a work in progress. I've had a lot of discussions with Rich about staffing, about what we need in the building, what's deficient that we need to expand on staffing. Are too many, too few? What's our numbers? So again, we're going to continue those discussions along the way as well. So with that, would you mind walking us through it?
How do you want to do it first? Do you want to go through the binder tabs first so that we can see what's in the binder, or do you just want to hit straight to the budget?
Straight to
the budget. All right, so then I'm going to actually do the narrative first just because there's some points in there that I just wanted to highlight.
As far as the budget goes, if there's any additional information, whether it's tonight or anywhere along the process, that you feel would be valuable, not only for you to get a better handle on the budget, but if you find anything that might be good information for the budget committee that's not included in the binder, just let us know so we can put it together, because we want inclusive binders for everybody that will have all of the information that anybody would need, so.
Yep, good. Okay, so starting with the highlights, the revenue is a decrease from last year or current year due to the transfer of that fund balance from the $75,000. That's basically what the difference is right now. We haven't received any of our estimates from the state yet. That's usually due in around the 15th of November, so those will just get flat at the current rate, so those will change. So it's basically an estimate right now. In this proposal, the budget as it stands right now is at $5,724,558, which is down by $139,757 from the current year.
Or almost 2.5%.
Yeah. Just a couple of notes on the second page. It excludes any warrant articles that we might put in and SAU expenses. So right now,
well, any increase
right
to the SAU.
Right now,
so
yes, it's left flat. Okay. Yep. Okay. Because the SAU board isn't meeting until the 19th. So until that's determined what the budget is, I just left it at the current rate.
Right, but it does say any SAU expenses. So
yeah,
just trying to say increases
yeah.
too.
Right? Yeah.
It would be helpful, Sylvia. I looked and said, sure,
yeah.
I shouldn't put
no, it
in there.
No, it's in there. So as of this report, the medical insurance, we estimated an 8% increase over our rates. I said we hadn't received our rates yet, but we did get them last night, so I do have them for people.
We're waiting with bated breath.
So,
good.
Yes. So I'm not sure what, Carl, have you guys done in the past, the billing rate or the effective rate?
We've always done the least expensive.
So that's the effective rate.
Yeah,
so based on
the
effective rate, that is going down by 9.7%.
What? It's going down by
9.7%.
So instead of an increase of 8, it's going down.
It's going down by 9.
Almost 10.
Yes.
Well, thank you to our healthy group, I guess.
Yes.
How does that happen? Is it because we have a healthy group?
Well, we actually had a meeting with school care today. They came over and did some, showing us some trends of what's happening. And
yeah, they went through all of the factors with people being the smart shopper and looking around and utilizing all of the healthy activities and the teledrug and the wellness and every piece of that is trending in the right direction, so it's good news.
That is absolutely wonderful, and it means it's a swing of 17, almost 18% down. It's a swing.
So in the next version of the budget, this will be adjusted to those rates. The dental insurance is still in here at an estimated 3% increase. Retirement rates, this was one of the years where those have changed. However, I don't think they're that bad. The teacher rate went from 17.36 in the current year to 17.8. And the employee rate went down. It was 11.38 this year, went down to 11.17. So I've seen it way worse than this in years past. So I don't think it's that bad. Our workers' comp did decrease 3.5%, so that's good.
Again, that's due to claims, so that's again good. Yeah. Stuff. Everyone's staying healthy.
Same with property liability, that went way down.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's surprising. The liability went way down.
Yeah.
Again, claim based, or we must have come off a claim.
I don't know, but they also had given us. Remember, we signed those guaranteed maximum rates too. So that's a decrease as well. The Marshwood tuition rate increased by $429.78 per student.
Okay, that's a jump. Do you know the percentage of that jump? I can do the math.
I thought it was 4%.
Okay, and Bob, you'll explain it to us. He'll explain that to us, because I know you have the details on that. Okay.
And then I just put a note in here that we had done a lot of work this year on making sure the expenditures are put in the proper account codes. So you're going to see throughout the budget new lines that have never been used or budgeted before, but other lines are going to be decreased because we're putting them in the proper places. So I just wanted to give you a heads up about that. So when we look at the budget, it may look a little different than it has in the past. All right, so. And then I also included all the function and object codes in case you want to look up what they need.
Can I ask you a quick question from the very beginning?
Yeah.
The expenditure section. When you say that it's approximately 2.44% less than fiscal year 18-19 approved budget, does that include warrant articles?
Yes, for 18-19. Once they get approved in March, they get added to your budget number. So
yes, just making sure.
Alright, so then we'll go to the budget, and you just want me to go through line by line? So the first section is teacher salaries. So we are negotiating. So the only thing included in this line for increases is longevity for any eligible teachers. Rich had asked that we make the literacy interventionist, who is currently part-time, move that to full-time. So that's included in this line, and one track change.
So that's included, but it's not something that we've approved yet.
It's included. The next line, the tutor, the aide salary is flat because it stays the same as this year because we're negotiating. The next one, tutor salary, it looks like it's an increase, but it really isn't because all we did was reclassify that because right now it's a tutor and it's being classified under as a mainstream coach. So we pulled it out of mainstream coach and put it where it belongs as a tutor. So you'll see it when we get to function 1210 where the mainstream coaches are, that line has gone down. It's just a reclassification. The same thing goes for the sub-salary line. We reallocated those so that they're in the proper function. So this would be for regular ed substitutes.
Oh, okay. So
we also added a line under special ed for substitutes. Before, it was all lumped into regular ed.
Even for special ed?
Yes. So everything got charged to regular ed. So we decided we would allocate it to each of the funds. So even though this looks like it went down 8,000, it's allocated in those other funds.
That was the first question I had here, is why is that going down? It's better, much better to have it in the proper place.
Yeah.
So you can see. Excellent. Okay.
So the next line is actually something new. So I explained it in my budget update. So what I did, because if you remember correctly last year, the staff brought to our attention that we were kind of identifying people's health plans for some of these lines where we have one employee who is in that function code, so it was easy to identify. So what I've done is I've taken all the benefit lines, health, dental, retirement, FICA, life, long-term disability, and lumped them all together into one benefit line so you cannot identify what is health, what is retirement, what is everything, because it's all one. So this line is for regular ed, total benefits. Like I said, it includes health, dental, life, long-term disability, FICA, and retirement. And again, that was based on an 8% health rate increase, a 3% dental increase. retirement also increased and FICA because we made the literacy interventionist full-time. So that now puts her at retirement eligible. So now we
have next year.
For next year. So now we have retirement benefits and FICA goes up based on the salary increase. The retirement rate increase is included in there and the decrease for the employees and then a track change. So those were all the things that attributed to that $35,000 increase in that one. You're going to see that in every function too. Everything's going to be lumped together.
That's good.
The next line is contracted services for technology. That stayed the same.
I'm not sure. Everyone go with the line by line, or do you want to just go to the ones that have changes? Or?
When we go to ones that have changes.
Just changes, okay.
For the moment.
We can always go back.
So the next one is internet access. It went up by $8,800.
Yeah.
I don't know. Rich can probably talk more about this, but it looks like it's construction cost to run fiber from the railroad to the school, which would improve reliability and speed.
Tom's been talking about upgrading the internet service here at the school, especially since we've got more devices being used at the same time. So there are times when it's a little bit slower, it's not capable of anything. I'm not doing, that tech speaking, but he's looked into the cost, and over the summer he made me aware that he was going to put in a request. He said, we're fine if we continue doing what we're doing, but the more that people use technology within the classrooms during instruction, we're going to see less and less capabilities. Kids will have harder times, accessing different pieces. So it is a one-time cost to cover, the fiber running, the new fiber running from down to where the railroad is up the street to ours. So we have that access. It's just we have to pay that cost to get it.
It's also more per month, it looks like.
Yes, So because it's a higher speed and better quality, the increase per month goes up as well. So future costs will be
$6,000
instead of the $2,200.
So now. Yeah, I mean, and one of the things just, it's important to know where some of these changes are coming from, like the making the literacy interventionist, this cost. We're used to seeing those sort of separately as the recommendations from just a certain, they need to be in the budget, but we're used to seeing them broken out separately so we can look at what's new this year. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm not saying it well. We used to get a sheet showing what those.
So put them in here and then do a separate list.
It helps us look at total.
Sure.
And my way of the changes.
But thank you, that's great.
So the next section is regular ed tuition, so that's for Marshwood. It's based on the tuition rate increase, as I said at the beginning, and then I adjusted it to enrollment, so I took the current sixth graders and moved them up to the seventh grade. So those are those increases and decreases there.
As far as that goes, your tuition is up, but your number of students is down, so that's why you've got a decrease instead of an increase.
And to be clear, it's not that our number of students are down. Marshwood has lost, they had a bubble moving through and they had a big drop. So we are one, instead of being one of 100, we're one of 90. You know, it's like
that formula.
It's the formula.
So the next section, general supplies, again, this shows a decrease, but you're going to see new lines underneath there that we've broken it out by department. So underneath general supplies is general supplies math, which is an increase of 1,000. General supplies reading, increase of 500. Mm-hmm. General supplies science, 393.
Just to that point, in the past, we've had a catch-all general supplies. And we wanted to break it out so we, over time, we have history as to whether the math department or whatever needed more supplies or less supplies or what the history was. So it just added a little bit of clarity.
Mm-hmm. And if you want specifics too, I'm sure Rich has, different
So the total of that looks like it's a little higher.
It's a little higher, yeah.
But if you look at previous year's costs, it's actually lower. We just spent almost $20,000 last year. I tried to keep it under that amount, but I didn't want to cut the general supply too much because I don't know where we're at this year because everything's coming out of that line.
Right. Oh, right, it's all coming out of that line. Much better accounting.
So you're gonna see the same thing under subscriptions, it's a huge decrease of 9,400.
Yeah.
But again, it was a catch-all, so everything was coming out of that print media. It was used to be called print media, so everything was getting lumped into there. So Rich decided we're gonna call that subscriptions because that's really what that was. And then we broke it out by classroom reference books and classroom workbooks instead of lumping it all into print media. Because really what they were taking out of print media was more like subscriptions to software and things like that, not really physical print media books, you know what I mean? So those are now further detailed out and broken out. Software is a decrease of $500. I guess that's just based on need. Technology new equipment also is a decrease of $30,700, but if you see underneath it, we've broken it out again by replacement equipment and new equipment. So things will be budgeted in here that are going to be new. And then if we have to replace certain equipment, that will be allocated under replacement. And then there's also some requests for by department for music and phys ed for equipment.
For technology or for
equipment?
No, just for
just
equipment.
Straight equipment.
In the past,
oh, that's not under the general.
In the past, you had one line that just basically said equipment, and from there, you did your technology new equipment. You did your, your big equipment for the gym or around, and it was not very clear as to what it was budgeted for. So we separated out the technology and then any equipment, which is over $100. Equipment is over $100 with more than a 3-year lifespan. So anything that falls in that is equipment, and we'll detail it out in the budget.
Excellent. Okay. And then there's a small, we took out other equipment because now we're allocating it where it belongs. So we didn't need another equipment line if everything's being put into where it belongs. So that's the decrease of $240. And then page 3 is the same thing, new equipment for math. There's some dry erase boards, some new equipment for reading, for easels for the first and second grade classrooms, new equipment for science, a chiller for fish eggs.
That's chiller for the fish eggs.
And then
caviar.
And then new equipment for art, for sketch boards, and phys ed for mini basketballs. So those are all the equipment lines that we added to break it up. So any questions on regular ed?
No, overall it was an increase, I see, but 31,000.
Yeah, okay.
Yep. Anyone else?
We'll go down a little bit with the healthcare adjustment.
Yeah, healthcare adjustment, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Okay, so under special ed, again, no change to salaries because of negotiations happening. The only increase there is $100 for longevity. You'll see under mainstream coach salaries, like I said, that decrease there for the tutor line being brought back to regular ed because that's where it belongs. And then there was $5,735 budgeted here for tutor salaries. That was for the district's portion of the Title I tutor, which we don't have the Title I tutor anymore, so
right.
I decreased that line. And then substitute salary sped, there's the increase to break it out for special ed substitutes. Again, there's a little bit of FICA and retirement in there. So page 4 is the total sped benefits. So it's a decrease right now of $3,182. That could just be based on change in plans or things like that. And then the next section is sped tuition. So this is the special ed tuition to Marshwood. So this is all, the base tuition for your SPED students as well as the services that they get, the menu. So there was an increase for the middle school, but a decrease for the high school. And that's just based on the enrollment shifting
on the need.
Yep.
Right.
And just to add a little clarity to the special education, because you can see the numbers there, and feel free to jump in, Pam. I met with, there was some confusion as to the billing process and how we budgeted and how we billed, and I met with Mary Nash and asked questions about that. And on your bill, the billing had been for direct services, and then they were rounding up to the closest hour for the billing purposes. And when I met with her, my first reaction was, well, why are we rounding up for direct services? And her answer was, they're rounding up for direct services because as the year goes on, consultations, meetings, paperwork, those types of things are not being billed for, which is, they are identified in your contract. So as long as they are not billing for those tasks, then it makes sense to round up for the direct services. And I think that that's where the discrepancy was in the billing in the past, because we were budgeting for, and again, correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm doing history here, we were budgeting for not only the direct services, but we were budgeting for the consultations, the team meetings, and everything else, which is in your contract. So as long as we are not being charged for the direct services rounding up and the consultations and the paperwork and everything, the meetings, then we're okay. So in doing that, that's why this number is down, because now we're not budgeting for that second piece. We're budgeting for what's actually direct services identified in the IEPs. So it should be much more accurate than it has been in the past.
That's important.
So we need to just be aware that if there is any change, then that all of a sudden there isn't a new way that in the future that they
will
hit us with that.
I responded, yeah. I met with Mary Nash, and then I responded in a letter clarifying that and got a response back saying, yes, you're absolutely right. So we have that, and we're going to check the bills as we go through the year.
All right, we get the bills every month. Yeah. Every month for the last year and a half, I've been going through and comparing the bill to what the services are that are ordered in the IEP.
So as long as that,
yeah,
as long as that billing is accurate to that, then this budgeting should
be. So they've been doing that from the start, then?
Yes.
Okay.
Which is why you've had savings over the years in those in that special ed line.
So that's in.
Yeah. Yes, but it took a long time to get it clarified. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah. but while we're on that subject, as I looked at something that's in our. Enrollment class size, the special ed a la carte things. I understand rounding up when you have a 50 minutes and you add 10 minutes on. It seems excessive to add 36 minutes to 2 hours. That seems excessive. Can you explain how they explain that rather than just making it 20 or 25 minutes?
Yeah, in the if they're consistent doing that and we're consistent checking the bills,
okay,
and budgeting that way, it works out, and actually it works out to our advantage.
Okay.
Because of those other services. Now, okay. I would have a different opinion if they were still billing us for the consultations and the meetings and the testing and the assessments and those things.
Okay.
Then you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
But the way that if we're consistent with the way they're applying it and we're checking it, then it makes sense.
Does the math actually work in our favor, though, based on the number of consults? I mean, does it actually add up to
more? Well, figure each special ed student has at least one meeting a year.
Right.
Sometimes more, sometimes
okay.
not less, because they at least have one meeting a year. But sometimes more. And so, while it's...
Well,
it's
I
not
think
a
I'm
real
trying,
clear, crystal
sorry.
Clear way of billing us. I wish they would put a space that says, you know, this is how much we're going to charge you.
Well, in the long run, you know, we have talked about that, about doing a tiered system and putting, you know, the services that students need into three or four different tiers and cost them out appropriately. That way you're paying one long stuff. But that's something that you're gonna have to work out.
I think the Judy point, though, that's a very, I mean, because using your, you know, example, I'm not sure if it's true, if it actually needs to go that way.
Actually, I see it now, now that I hear all the explanations, I see it as a step between doing it, doing it to the minute or to the hour of actual time, and between, this is a step between that and a tiered system. It's saying that for, we're gonna charge you an hour for every 50 block time, and we're gonna charge you 2 hours for every 84 minute block. And that's, but you're gonna bundle in all this other stuff that goes with it. And so I can see that that's a good step. That's the way I'm seeing it.
And the proof really is in your budget.
And yeah.
You know, we went down through here, and my hat's off to Pam. She's been really diligent in looking at the budgets individually and down to the minute, so.
And also, this will also, once, now that you understand, I'm assuming it will save a little bit of time when you're going through, you're pouring over the budgets.
Yeah, not for this year anyway.
Not for this year.
Well, for each and every student in the campuses, and compare it to the bill. I just, they need a cleaner way of billing us.
Maybe.
Agree.
Yeah, and Mary Knapp seemed very fairly receptive of continuing discussions, so, you know, maybe as the year goes on, we can sit down and try to do a tier and try to do something that makes sense and then have some discussions and perhaps we can put it into play for next year.
Well, that's great. I think those are excellent steps forward. So it's, do you have other questions or thoughts on that?
I do agree, though. I think that's something we should probably, you know. I mean, we were saying that this is kind of clunky.
It is.
That, you know, it's trying to figure out, you know, why is it clunky? Is it because of they're rounding up and not charging for other things? Because, and then the question is, okay, well, you're rounding up, why aren't you rounding up to the quarter hour, or why are you rounding up to the hour?
Right.
Because it's still money. I mean, you're still talking about a set cost for the service.
Exactly.
So you're paying for something, and you're right. We may see a reduction, but that's because we're basing the budget on what we think it's going to cost. And if it comes down, well, yeah, because we're not being charged for other things, but we may be paying. I'm just throwing this out there because I wasn't aware this was how it was being done. But if we're budgeting everything based on full hours, yeah, we should be getting money back every month. We should try to be more accurate.
See, ultimately, this is why I think it's important eventually to get to a tiered system, because in special education, nothing is the same.
Right.
You know, your testing is not the same, child to child. You know, the testing is, the assessments are different, the team meetings, some need one, some need five. I mean, it's nothing, you can't just go down and say, all right, every student needs this, this, and this. It doesn't work that way.
No, but the services themselves have a set cost. So, if, you know, I get what you're saying. You're right. I mean,
well, yes,
not,
no,
they're all snowflakes. They're not going to be the same. But it's the point that if we know how much of a specific service is going to cost, then we should, based on the idea, we should be able to figure out, okay, well, it's going to cost around this.
Kind of.
But they're rounding up on everything. And it's, I mean, that works.
No, I understand that, but
others, you know?
It, for the budgeting purposes, it's still a best guess.
Right.
Because, I mean, even if you take something like an IEP meeting, you know, some last 20 minutes, some might last 4 hours.
Yes.
So it for budgeting purposes, that makes it a little
funky.
I mean,
right.
That's where it's difficult.
When we first started preparing for this whole thing, we went by their out-of-park venue,
right.
And we met with their BA and their special ed director. Marie and I met with them, and we figured out what we were going to be charged. And at that time, they said to us, we're going to charge you for, you know, the principal to attend meetings, the assistant principal, school psychologist, the special ed director, the teachers, the service personnel. And so when a kid had all of those people that were going to be at that meeting, we put in that cost because that's what they told us. But they did not charge us.
They didn't. And I commend you for sticking with it, Pam. I know it's been tough, and now there's been a change in administration, but I think we're getting some, finally getting some clarity. And this language about rounding up was only added last year. Marshford only added it last year, and we were, as you know, we were stuck with, you know, different administrations and a little, you know, in between things, and so we kind of left it for this year to be straightened out. It sounds like Bob has reached a good place with it, and have him continue what's going on.
There are going to be some changes. Pam and I went through the spreadsheet of students and services, and today there were some changes. So in the next version, you might see a little variation. Less of an amount, slightly less. Yeah.
Okay. You're going to find a number of lines that, as we move through this, we're going to get them up to date. So your tuition lines are going to go up and down. Your special ed lines are going to go up and down. I mean, obviously not huge, but you know, we're taking a snapshot. Somebody moves out of district, they leave, come out of our budget. Somebody moves in the district, they go into our budget. So we're going to try to get it.
Right, you're going to try to get in a place where we're going to be budgeted by the end of the year.
Yeah, and then we'll have a discussion about, you know, do we want to put in a tuition or three?
I did not do that at this point. I left it as current enrollment. So right, that is a discussion we can have.
Well, we're going to have that discussion and start talking more in dark. Right. I want to leave about 5 or 6 minutes to discuss.
So next section is still sped tuition, but it is for out-of-district placements. So you'll see an increase to middle school and then a big decrease for high school, and that's just based on the current enrollment that we have. So that's it for special education. Total decrease of $197,938.
Why the summer's worth number is not considered out of district?
Out of district is for students that aren't within our schools, so they're in like a placement.
Yeah, the LEA is outside state, and it really is. I mean, it's a placement to someone's work. I mean, that's
It's probably because it's always been its own line because that's where you went prior to. So,
but should it be?
And you have a tuition agreement with them, so that's probably why it's separated out and not lumped into an out of district placement.
Okay, we do still have tuition agreement.
Yeah.
We don't want to get too deep into this discussion. This is special ed, it has to do with the fact that Maine ages out at 20, New Hampshire ages out at 21.
No, I was more questioning that Summersworth is not technically our district.
Well, it's true.
We're talking about out-of-district placement because...
I see what you're saying. It is an out-of-district placement. It could
be lumped in there, or should it not be lumped in there? That's my only question about
that. That's a very good question. I think it could be out-of-district.
I could do that.
That's a very good question.
I feel like it might not...
Thanks for clarifying.
...pull that one out as noticeably.
Mm-hmm. They are tuition students.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's fine.
Do we have tuition agreements with the other out of
district
placement?
No,
we
don't have that.
Well, we have one with
Summersworth.
Summersworth is
kindly, I believe, viewing to the agreement as however many students we have in that are aging.
Okay, so the only thing else on this page is under attendance services, we did increase that line. It's always been $40. Nothing has ever been spent out of it. And if I remember correctly, I think it was to pay the police department if we needed somebody to go to check on a student that doesn't attend school. But things have come up, I guess, in the past where we don't really know what to do, I guess, if we have a truancy issue. So we've added $500 there in case we need to pay a stipend for somebody to be...
Yeah, we thought we'd bill it out hourly. If we use the services, then we'll bill it out hourly. Yep. If we don't use the services, then obviously it's the
same thing. So the next section is guidance. The only change there is the benefits changes. And then, again, the new equipment, breaking that out by guidance.
That's nice, yeah.
Same with the nurse, only change is benefits at this point.
I don't know, the Band-Aids, I spent
$40 increase for supplies for Band-Aids, and have the nurse software increased a little bit based on just actual cost for the software. Speech, same thing, it's just benefits. Supplies went down by $36, but we increased software by $50 for vouchers for the iPads for Apple. Under PT and OT, decreased for the services by $882, but we did add a line for supplies, because there really, there wasn't one for supplies.
It was in the catch-all.
Yeah, so we've broken it out. The next section is testing services, that went down, and that's based on not using, right, you don't use the NEWA testing anymore. Is that correct, Rich? Yes, so that's a decrease.
Yeah, I think that has been going down over the last couple of years, because we're doing so much more.
Doing other assessments.
Global assessment, global testing assessments.
Subscription and books went down by $150, that again is just, we moved it to the regular education line under subscription, so we didn't need it down here. Librarian, there was a change in, for a track change, and then the benefits changes. Supplies went up by $600.
Or there will be.
Yes, yeah. Furniture went up by $1,000 for stools and bookshelves, looks like.
Very comfortable stools, by the way, for those of us that were just sitting in there. Didn't you find those stools there? For a stool?
We had to.
And an increase of $1,500 for library software.
Some of that has shifted from the technology software line to regular ed. Tom had me move that into the library.
Because it was specific to the library.
Specific to her needs.
It's good, it's great that it's become a little bit more specific. Good direction of going.
I increased advertising, board advertising by $2,000, that's for the school spring that you approved, so I do that in for next year. That's it on the school board line. The retirement rate for the secretary went down, just based on the new grades, by $5. Page eight, I did increase the audit by $2,000, because that's what we've been spending, it's around $13,000, so I increased that. I left legal services flat, SAU is flat for right now, but that will change. Under school administration, Rich did ask to increase the head teacher stipend by $250, right now it's $1,000, so we increased that to $1,250. There is a 2% salary increase, that changed from the first time you guys looked at the budget, so we changed it to the 2%.
Yes, 2% has been our go-to. We try to stick with what the town, I don't know what the town's doing this year.
So that's built in for the non-union staff, as well as the benefit changes on those lines. Postage went up by $200, just based on usage. And printing went down by $275, I think that was also one of the, included in the catch-all, right? I think you moved it to regular ed for the printing of the agenda, I think that was agenda books or something, wasn't it?
No, we hadn't spent that.
Oh, you hadn't spent it, so. Property liability, like I said, that went down by $1,855. Under custodial, you'll see a big decrease in salaries, that is due to the fact that Rich recommended that in his other districts, the facilities director is broken out. Before, the facilities director was included in custodial salary, so now we've broken him out into his own line, so you can actually see the facilities director salaries and benefits in his own line. So that's the, between that and the 2% salary increase, that's the net of that.
So is he kind of allocating his time based on, or is it just?
No, it's just where his salary was allocated to, it was allocated to the custodial salary line, and instead we're breaking it out into its own line.
Facilities.
Yep. I mean, most administration is broken out into its own line, it shouldn't be really long to.
I mean, he is a full-time custodian.
Right.
As well as being the facilities director. But, you know, it's fine with me, whatever makes the most sense to anyone else, but.
And if you don't want it, I mean, we can certainly put that, but.
Just add a little bit clearer.
So that's the differences there.
Because he didn't, he's not hourly, he's not day-by-day, so.
We did add a line for custodian professional development, because there was not one, and they do go to some professional development opportunities, so we broke that out. Same with travel. There wasn't a line for travel, but there is travel that is done along with those professional development opportunities. So we added 500 there.
One more clarity.
Yes, good. The custodial equipment line went down by $1,000. That's just based on the need there. There were four items listed there that are purchased. The custodial equipment replacement line is a new line for $4,400. That's going to take care of water heaters in the kitchen, a sump pump, and a burnisher.
A sump pump burnisher or a sump pump and a burnisher?
And a burnisher. I'll move that burnisher to the desk one.
Because I wondered what a sump pump burnisher was. I don't know what a burnisher is.
I'll move that. It's a floor. To make them shiny. So that's that section. Utilities, I did increase the telephone based on our past usage. We've been budgeting $3,000. We've been spending about $3,600 to $3,700. So I bumped it up to $4,000 to give us what we've been spending. And then the same with oil. I mean, the last couple of years, it's been, you know, a little over $20,000. So yeah. Or at least last year. So I did bump it up to $25,000. I mean, we can bump it back down if we feel comfortable, but I bumped it up for now for discussion.
We'll see what we get to on the wrong number. Yeah.
So the next section, trash removal, that I also bumped up by $400 because that's what we've been spending. So I just, it's based on actuals. Ground maintenance is $18,000. I don't know if Rich wants to speak to the projects that are going to be done. Or...
Well, this is where we've made some breakouts.
Yeah, we did.
And you'll see that on the next page, the maintenance repairs has gone down to offset.
Oh yeah, I see. Yeah, it's gone down. It's almost a.
Yeah. Yep. Split it out to house maintenance and building maintenance. So building maintenance is the maintenance repair line.
But I will tell you though, under maintenance repairs, there was $93,000 budgeted in there for a warrant article for the roof. So really, it's up.
That's true.
Just to note that. So.
Oh right, right.
So it's really up from last year.
What is compared?
Yes. So undergrounds maintenance, additional parking on the north side of the building. Wood fibers for the playground, replacement of the Bigfoot slide, landscaping, soil, machine work, and seed. Beach sand for the playground. I think that's everything right there.
Yeah. And the landscaping soil, I think, is also for
that area. So that's what's included in that $18,000. Under the maintenance repairs, like I said, $93,000 came off the top because that was for the roof of the one article that passed last year. So the other things that are included are studying the ventilation plans, painting the gym, painting the main building and the upper hall, ceramic tile, the halls and kitchen main building, paint and repair the cupola, insulate pipes in the annex, replace window in the kitchen and cubbies. Was there more than that too? Or is that everything? I think that was everything.
For some of these items, some of these are going to be, I think, relatively big ticket items, obviously not biggest ticket, but we sort of a projected cost.
Yep, I have those.
Yeah, okay.
Again, that's going to be on that sheet that we see.
I think there is more though. I think there's more. I think it might have cut it off because also on your notes I have replacing the door hardware, certain security cameras.
Katie, for this, purpose, can we add the cost that,
sure.
Right next to the notes?
Yeah.
That would be helpful.
Yeah.
And to see if we can get all of them.
Yeah, I'll add those two. Yeah. I think I just cut it off.
As we're looking at sort of the new things that are being planned, we're used to seeing the cost of each item, so we can sort of see it for the budget.
I can add that. And I'll add it to that new sheet I'm going to do anyway, where I can bring it up. So the next section, equipment maintenance agreements. These are like annual maintenance things that we do. Quarterly drinking water test, that's a new thing, I believe, that is a new requirement. Indoor air quality test, the fire extinguisher maintenance on the sprinkler, the fire alarm, the fire suppression system, the permits for the lifts. Those type of annual.
It's really great to have this list, but I see it went up quite a bit.
Yes.
Because it was in another line.
Thought so, but I mean it's great to have a list of what happened.
Yeah, the only new one is the drinking water test.
Yeah, that's a new requirement by the state.
That's good though. It's good.
And underground did something, underground did what, underground what?
I think that's the oil storage tank.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We'll double check that to make sure that all of them are safe.
Yeah.
It must be when I downloaded it to Excel.
The only underground tank we have is out here, right?
I think that's the last thing.
Okay.
And then decrease of $2,200 out of the upkeep of machinery. Again, it's just a reallocating it. We put it up to over there because transportation is based on the first student contract. That's the increase for this year. And it's broken up by middle and elementary. Special ed transportation. This is, I got the information from Pam based on our current students that we have attending. So you'll see a decrease for the elementary and then also a decrease at the high school. And I think that goes hand in hand with the other district placements that we're putting increase in. So.
Okay. So we have no special ed transportation for this year, correct? I mean, elementary.
I kept the after-school program flat because I assume that they're going to charge us this year. We did increase the transportation for the field trip line for $200 for each of the 9 classrooms. And then the next section is retirement buybacks. Those are based on the approved retirements.
Why does it say early retirement?
I think that might be how it's described in the... I mean, I can change the title of that.
I mean, it threw me off. Like,
yeah. And then, so that's what those are. The tuition workshop reimbursement line, it's a decrease of $24,000, but if you look underneath it, we added a new line called professional development because there was no line to bring professional development to the building versus having the teachers go to a workshop or things like that. So we've reclassified it for professional development, but there is still a decrease there. And then workers' comp, like I said, went down by $321. And then the last thing is the decrease of the $75,001 for the warrant articles from last year. So
all right.
Total decrease right now of $139,757.
Yep, so it's about $140. We're going to have increases in SAU costs, most likely, and decreases in health costs. Quick questions. We have to move on to our regular meeting. Questions from anyone right now? One of the things, I think we're probably going to need another budget meeting to finalize it, and we have to do it before our regularly scheduled school board meeting because this budget will be presented to the budget committee the day before our December school board meeting. So if people want to start looking at their calendars now, how do you want to do it? We are going to need to schedule one. So we have to have it, it has to be finalized no later than, I would say, December 7th for a presentation on the 12th. That Bob and I talked about the last time we met was Bob and Katie and Pam and everyone else have been working very hard to get this budget in a better position. And Bob is very used to presenting. He's very familiar. We're very fortunate to have him here. He's very familiar with SB2 budget committees and things like that. And he has something to present.
Love that.
So I think as a board, we've worked hard to understand. We've worked hard to have our goals of reducing the budget overall, and we've done a good job of it. But I also think it's a good chance. It would be a good opportunity for Bob to present. So we can talk
can go through the budget, and if there's a special education line, naturally Pam knows more about it than I do. If there's something to do with tax implications, Katie knows more than I do. If there's something to do with programs in the building, Rich would know more than I do. So at that point in time, wherever the question comes, we've got the answer instead of saying, I'll get back to you.
That's wonderful idea.
So it's just, it's worked pretty well.
And I'm sure the budget committee would appreciate that as well.
I'm looking forward to it. I think it'll be a good opportunity for the whole town to be able to be involved and see Bob in action. I guess it'll be good. All right, well, hold the thought on scheduling this. Now, unless anyone has a pressing question, we are going to move on to our regularly scheduled meeting.
Can we just schedule it?
Yes, sure.
Yes, everyone has their calendar. Sorry, we're just all right here and ready.
Suggestions, throw out suggestions.
The budget committee has another presentation on the 5th, so I won't be able to.
On the when?
The 5th of December.
The 5th, so that's out.
So that's out. I'm away on Friday.
When's Thanksgiving? It's what, the 24th?
26th.
29th of November?
And I have another budget presentation on the 28th, or 27th, I think it's 27th.
We have school board negotiation.
On the 28th.
At 4.
All right, what do we hear on the 27th for people?
Good, and 27th.
You could use it. Yes, Tom's not in.
What time?
What about Katie and Bob? 27th, it's a Tuesday. Sounds like it might be tough.
I wish I had a problem.
What works, Mark? What's the earliest people could?
I'm pretty flexible on time on that day.
5:30, is that too, is 5:30 too early?
No, it just happened today. My job sometimes doesn't allow me to, but I.
All right, 27th, pending Bob's checking his calendar. And time, is 5:30 work for people for the budget workshop to finalize the budget?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
Put it in right now.
All right. So, 27th. Budget workshop.
It's the one there, it'll be.
And we're gonna say 5:30?
Just the budget.
All right.
Is that here?
Oh, Rich, is that work for you? Sorry.
Yes, here.
So where are we gonna have it?
Here.
Right here?
Does here work for everyone?
Yeah, except for one drop.
Here or SAU?
They have a whole gym.
Oh.
Which I will be at, yes. I am not missing.
Well, you're not missing it, then you're not available to come to.
I'll be here, but you can't have it here, though.
I see.
In a room?
I don't have it in one room.
Yeah.
Okay.
Library, whatever.
I'm so glad I have.
Library, very comfortable stools.
Very.
Those kids would have been running around us.
All right.
Okay, are you meeting?
All right, so, thank you. We'll get back to that. So, a little bit late, we will come back. I think we have a couple of budget items to come back to. We need to do the regular thing. All right, we will now call the regularly scheduled board meeting to order. Melinda.
Judy Nelson.
Yes.
Tom Coons.
Yep.
Emily Leach.
Here.
Andrea Anderson.
Here.
Erin Kavanaugh.
Here.
We will stand and look at the United States of America and look for a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. To the United States, no flag. Thank you.
It's the, our last budget workshop, our last school board and the enrollment consent calendar. What's the board's pleasure on the consent calendar?
I'll second whatever that was.
Okay, and for further discussion, the only thing that I noticed in some of the, is that some of the amounts, and this is not, this is some reason to pull it out, I'll actually just hand the sheet over to, it's just that amounts got changed from 25,000 to 2,500 or the other way around. Just a couple of places they got changed around, it's just a typo, so. Any further discussions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries, and we move forward. Announcements, communication, superintendent's update.
All right, a couple of things. The SAU withdrawal update, I'll give you a brief update, and then we've got it under discussion items, and I can give you more information during that as well. Where it stands right now is the Somersworth School Board has approved the withdrawal and process and has moved it on to the City Council. The City Council held a public hearing, and it will be on the City Council agenda for December 3rd to make a determination at that point whether they're going to move forward. If they decide to move forward at that point, they would determine a committee that would take all of the information gathering through the process. So the process, start to finish, is approximately a year and a half to 2 years to get the whole thing done. So it's not anything we're going to fly through, but they are putting it on their agenda for December 3rd.
So, excuse me, they approved their withdrawal?
Yes. Well, they approved their, they've approved to move forward with the process of their withdrawal from the SAU. So it's not approving their withdrawal, it's approving the process for their withdrawal.
Okay.
But yes, theirs.
Theirs, not ours. Theirs.
Correct. Correct. So during the discussion tonight about the SAU withdrawal, which is on your budget, I mean on your agenda, you need to have that discussion about what to do and what your options are, and I have more information at that point. The Marshwood tuition update. In your packet, you'll see the Rollinsford tuition calculation. When we first got our calculation, it was up a little bit more than this, and it was because there was a total of 95 students drop in the Marshwood enrollment, which in turn, with fewer students, rises your per pupil expenditure. One of the changes in your contract, it says that it will be determined by the April 1st certified enrollment. Well, the state of Maine has changed it, and now they're only certifying enrollment October 1st. So there was no certified enrollment for April 1st, so they had determined that they were going to utilize October of 18 as the certified enrollment for your tuition calculation. Now, seeing 95 student change, I questioned that because you were going basically a year and a half, and part of setting tuition is cost equalization over a period of time. So if you use different dates, mm-hmm. then in theory you were missing this past year, present year in your calculation. So I asked them to provide me with a number of what it was on April 1st, even if it wasn't certified by the state. And it was slightly higher. So that's why if you look on this piece of paper here, the enrollment, certified enrollment this year was 2141, and last April it was at 2149. So I asked them to stick with the April enrollment of 2149. It was a slight adjustment downward for the per pupil. So $10,598 is your tuition for this year. Now, the question before the board is, from this point forward, do you want to go to the October 1st certified enrollment to set that? Now, I think that with the adjustment that we just made, it shouldn't be that big of a jump. I was just concerned that a 95 student jump is, I wanted to make sure that it wasn't just for that 1 year and you're paying for it. So, but it was about a, what is that, 87 student difference anyway. So I think that, if you decide to go to October 1st, it's a certified enrollment through the state of Maine, it's consistent, and that might make sense. But I didn't want to do that without touching base with you first.
Yeah, I think it makes sense, and it should be, hopefully you have the list of things we're keeping track of for when we renegotiate the contract in another year. We should certainly make sure that that is.
I have a list already.
That this is something that it's obviously going to be made official before that, perhaps, but.
Right, if that's what the board wants to do, I will get back in written form to Mary Nash, just letting her know that that's been confirmed through our board and acceptable, and that's the way we will cover it. That's all I have for now.
Thank you all. Principals update.
So I just wanted to touch on a couple of things in my report, and then I have one other piece of information for you based on a question at last month's meeting. Most of my first page is about professional development. I feel like we've been inundated with professional development. October was extremely busy, and it's carried over to the beginning of November. So our staff is getting a lot of support in instruction and inquiry, math. Tomorrow, we've got the privilege of having gentleman Bob Greenleaf come and do a presentation on neuroscience and brain, and talk about brain-based teaching and how it's different for students based on how their brain works. I've seen Bob a couple of times in previous districts. He does a nice job. He's extremely knowledgeable, former teacher, principal, superintendent in Maine, and now he tours the world presenting about his research on brain. And then tomorrow afternoon, we have our math consultant coming back to talk and do sort of a refresher, but we've got a lot of new staff as well, including myself, about math language. We all know that math has changed over the years, and using the language and consistent strategies across the building to ensure that students aren't going into different grades with different people or going into special education and learning differently so that they're confused from one room to the next. So she's coming back to do an overview about that. We have our student-led conferences in the next couple of weeks, and I haven't looked at the list, but I feel that a majority of parents have signed up already for student-led conferences. If we get a few more each day, but aren't able to do it during open house. So teachers are looking forward to that. It's a busy time for them to come out a couple of nights just before Thanksgiving recess, but they really enjoy having the students present their learning to their parents. I hold off on buildings and grounds because that's my additional handout. Our PTO is going strong. We had our third meeting last evening. Our new board has taken over the operation of the meeting, the running of the meeting. Still a few little things that we've got to work out from our prior PTO, because we've had a whole turnover and a lot of new parents with young children in the building joining this year. But a real excited and energetic group. A lot of staff members have been attending as well, so I've got high hopes that it's going to continue to flourish. Last evening we talked about doing next to last event on the list is an opportunity that's been afforded to us. We are taking the whole school to the Rochester Opera House for a production of The Nutcracker by Soul City Dancers. We have a student who's actually in the production, and we have a child of one of our staff members who's actually in the production. This will be free for all staff and students because the Summer's Worth Women's Club generously donated $2,500 to the school based on a request of mine. And it more than covers the cost of that. So we have some extra funds for additional field trips in the spring as well. So I wanted to give them public recognition for that. And then the last thing.
Before you go on to that, I'd really like to know the end of the sentence of these guys. These guidelines and rules were. It's the last sentence above school school events and dates. I just wanted to know that sentence.
This was one of the million times I was interrupted the day. Consistent playground expectations, but also trying to be aware that it's a time for kids to explore and do things that they're not allowed to do in a regular classroom. Make friends, interact, challenge themselves. So they helped us establish rules and guidelines based on safety, based on the age appropriateness. Some of the equipment is more appropriate for older students and what they can do on it, and some younger students may not be able to climb on top of things, for example, or jump off of something safely. So that's the direction I was going with that. And I was looking out there this evening. We've started painting some new activities out there for kids. Mr. Fortier has started that for us. The kids would like to have some foursquare spots out there, hopscotch. We started relining the basketball courts. And as we go along, we might put a couple of other things out there, especially for the winter time. They were looking for things to do on Hot Top. And we held them off last year, from what I've been told, because it was resealed and recoded this year. So that's the direction I was going to go.
Excellent about the Nutcracker.
So Tom brought up some questions about, do we have a five-year plan? Are there things that Dick looks for as he walks around the building? Those type of things. So next morning I met with Dick and asked the question, and he pulled out the five-year plan that he had created the first year that he was here. And unbeknownst to me, he also keeps a log of what he calls bigger projects. School improvements each year. So he kept a log of those bigger ticket items that we did throughout those 5 years. So I put together a two-sided sheet for you folks. The front page is his original five-year plan, and next to it I put whether it was completed or not completed. For your knowledge, the not completed tasks, other than the cupola, even though the cupola is $21,000, those bigger ticket tasks are big ticket items, many tens of thousands of dollars. But all of the other ones have pretty much been completed. And then on the back is a huge list of upgrades that have happened since Dick has been here. So it is time for a new five-year plan, because the current one ends this spring. Emily emailed me because she had questions from the budget committee, and I put a recommendation at the bottom because I've been a part of creating those in other buildings, that we just put together an ad hoc committee, facilities director, principal, superintendent, usually a board member joins that committee, and Dick also had somebody who's used to buildings and looking at building concerns. Plan and what costs it could cost the
just going to throw in my two cents of a five-year plan. In my line of work, if you had a five-year plan, you still reviewed it every year. So it was always 5 years out. It didn't come to an end and we started over again. And I think that we should try to adopt that model so that we're not just working off, if something happens, we're changing the plan if we have to. So just throwing that out. A five-year plan doesn't mean it ends in 5 years. It means it's a rolling plan.
Yes, and that's, I haven't had that positive experience in my other jobs, but yes, we are.
Well, believe me, we didn't even know this actually existed, so this is good. It was sort of anecdotal. This is excellent to have. Thank you. This is great. So we'll take a look at it and...
It's just for information, because you haven't seen it yet. I wasn't able to put it together for the packet.
Talk a little bit. We can talk about at some point maybe formally having at least one board member while working on that committee.
Also, just throwing this out there, there may be a community member who's qualified for that consultant role who will do it for free. Mm-hmm. People come to mind.
Mm-hmm. Once we start putting that together, I would definitely jump in for that one.
What? It's not me. It's a possibility, I think.
That'd be great to have that expertise in town and have them in the building. Great. Thank you. Any questions for Rich at this point? All right, well, moving on to discussion items. I see we have Nick with us tonight as our Marshwood student rep. So, Nick, you're on.
All right, so obviously I'm talking to Tony, but she has given me some things that she wanted me to talk about. First, sports. This is, right now we're kind of at the end of the fall sports season, the beginning of the winter sports. So playoffs are happening right now. Football, playing tomorrow for the regional title against Kennebunk. Varsity girls soccer made it 2 rounds in the playoffs this year. Varsity boys soccer made it 3 rounds in the playoffs and won a sportsmanship award, which is good. Golf team also won a sportsmanship award.
Well, can you tell me what that means, a sportsmanship award?
So, it's kind of like a committee of the referees and just like people around at the games throughout the year will kind of pick one team that has really shown that they're kind of like being good sports, I guess. Kind of like stepping up above the other teams, and we have a bunch of them hanging up in our gym, just like all across the walls at the top, all the sportsmanship awards. So this year, boys varsity and the golf team sportsmanship awards. And now we have all the winter sports getting signed up for, so we have basketball, indoor track, wrestling, and skiing. And those are starting up right after playoffs end. Quarter one ended, and quarter two is now started, so we're already a quarter of the way through the year. Seems crazy, but, NHS applications are due to National Honor Society. That was supposed to be in by November 2nd, and they're really strict about that deadline. 2:15 exactly, on November 2nd, or they won't accept them anymore. We'll know by the 14th of this month who is in and who isn't. And we have great teachers at the school who will sit down and talk to you about what exactly made it so you got here or not. So that's great. So especially if you don't get in, you can know because you'll be invited back next year, or at least I will. And the other juniors will be invited back next year. So they'll get to know what they need to fix so that greater chance of getting in.
So from what you're saying, does that mean you missed the deadline, Nick?
No, I did not miss the
deadline. Oh, I wasn't sure.
They are very, very strict about it.
Okay. You were emphasizing that so much, I just wondered if maybe you were 2:16 and they said, no, sorry.
I will admit I was pushing it. I got it. Megan wanted students that were accepted to college in, into a big list this year. So she emailed what we had so far, and all that's happened so far is Addie Hendrick was accepted to Hudson University. And of course that list will grow as the year goes on, but they do announce who gets accepted to college at school. So I think it's really nice to like recognize the students who are succeeding.
But that's great, and that would be nice for the board to hear.
Yeah.
It's a great idea. So that, that's a, an early acceptance that we're hearing about right now, correct?
Yeah.
Excellent.
And also going on right now is a district musical. They put a couple of those on a year. And they just take students all over the district, grades 3 through 12. This year they're performing Newsies, which is a Disney musical about a newspaper in New York City. And they perform this weekend and next weekend 5 times total, all of them in the auditorium at the high school. And we saw a little preview the other day on Wednesday, yesterday, and it was very, very good. I would recommend seeing it. Some of those, like even the third graders up there, are really, really good.
That's great.
And I was thinking, I don't know if it's a possibility or not, but I was thinking maybe there could be an invitation to Rawlinsford students that go here to maybe be able to audition for those district musicals. Because I know it's like, it's very closed off just to the NSAD school district right now. And I think it would be a good opportunity for some of the younger Rawlinsford kids to be able to go audition.
It's an excellent suggestion, and is that, I think that's something that maybe, I don't know, if Bob would take it at the superintendent level, or and or Rich, to just to see if Marshall was interested in including our students, and then we'll get to Rich.
Yeah, we'll get into that. Even I could talk to people, too. Like, one of the teachers is the director, I could talk to her. Some of my friends are in the play. Though my friends obviously wouldn't like be able to make any decision like that. But.
Well, you never know. Bring in a ringer from out of state.
So I could definitely talk to people and help out with that if that's an option.
That'd be great. Yeah.
It would be wonderful, Nick. It was a great suggestion.
Thank you.
And that's pretty much it for this month. I mean, still kind of just getting into the swing of things. Almost to midterms out of this quarter.
I know. I mean, it's a quarter's gone, and you're still just getting in this way. I don't know where this year is going, so yeah, it's gone.
Almost done.
Very good. Anyone else have any other questions?
Yeah,
any questions or thoughts for Nick? Ways to keep him busy?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Appreciate it very much. I appreciate you like the report. So thank you very much, and. He already knows that it's okay for him to go.
Yeah.
He's got that down, so okay. All right, the next item on our agenda is the SAU 56 withdrawal discussion. So far, we've had, Bob has been explaining to us sort of a little bit of what Summersworth is going through, how the Summersworth School Board had to go through a process, and then it gets placed in because they are a city, it gets placed in the city council's hands if they voted to study withdrawal, to go forward with looking at withdrawal, and it goes into a planning committee. And that will, so we'll hear from Bob and get him up to date, and we have some of the information that he also receives.
Yeah, some of the information is in your packet. I talked to Eric Christina of the School Board Association to pick his brain on this. Basically, the decision that you're going to have to make is, do you do nothing, or do you choose to start the process of withdrawal yourself? Because if you choose to start the process of withdrawal yourself, then that would be looking at a warrant article to go on in the spring. spring and forming a committee. And then, again, it's about a year to a year and a half after that, gathering all the information, seeing what your options are. If you do nothing, then ultimately, if I play this out from both sides, if you do nothing, then ultimately, in the end, if Summersworth pulls out, then you have SAU 56, whatever that means. Obviously, you'd have to do some drastic restructuring and modify it with my staff, myself. Where is it going to be? All of those things. If you choose to go through the process, then at that point in time, the committee that would, if the warrant article in the community says yes, go through the process, then at that particular time, that committee would gather all of the information on what that looks like. Do you keep the existing SAU? Do you form your own SAU? Do you hire a part-time, you need services of a superintendent, business administrator, and a special ed director? Do you hire part-time staff? Do you explore outsourcing to another SAU in the area, somebody that's nearby? Do you explore outsourcing to Marshwood? Is that even a possibility going across state lines? I don't know the answer to that definitely yet. So that would all come out in that committee if you choose to go through the process. Now, one of my questions to Barrett at the School Board Association was, what does that look like? Because you would have both entities going through the same process at the same time. Obviously, it's different for a city than it is for a town. And you can see, I put it in your packet, he feels like it would be in your best interest to start the process and take control of whatever you can take control of. And at any point in time in the process, if it got to the point where Summersworth, you were going to pull out and had a plan, then Summersworth could stop the process and keep SAU 56. Or if Summersworth had a plan and they were all set, then you could keep SAU 56 and modify it. But I think that my recommendation after talking with Barrett and trying to work through this is that it would be in your best interest to at least start the process and proceed as if you were pulling out, and then at least you would have a variety of options at that point.
Yeah, so this is a big thing. I mean, all we know about is what's been happening in the paper, pretty much. I took the opportunity this morning to look at the RSA that governs these kinds of things. And the process, while it's different for a city and a town, it's only in the timing and who's in charge. Our decision is to decide if we want to start the process. After that, it is out of our hands. Much like the withdrawal from the area agreement, a committee gets formed that would have two school board members. Because we are SB2 and we don't have a school meeting like a town meeting, we would have five public members, one of whom would be the superintendent, plus the superintendent, so five public members plus the superintendent. And it's in that committee's hands to do all the exploration, find out if it's even possible, if Martha would even consider talking to us about that. Anything else that's open to us to do.
So if we didn't initiate the process, then and Summersworth proceeded with going through the process. And in the end, they in fact decided to remove themselves from the SAU. We would be left, Rollinsford then would be left with, what would be our financial responsibility then? Still.
You would be left with SAU 56. Now, SAU 56, for all intents and purposes, at the end of that particular year, you would have to decide what services you wanted to keep, what services you wanted to reduce, what staff. I mean, it would be a drastic reduction in, I wouldn't anticipate that it would look like it is now.
So do we need to make
make a decision in time to get it on the warrant for, because we make the decision that we, yes, we would like to start our own process to withdraw. Then it goes to the public to vote on that in March. And that's just a majority needed for them to say, yes, continue with the process. Then the committee gets formed. If indeed the public agrees, if the voting public agrees, the committee gets formed. The committee then has a year to do their work so that the following March, so a year from this coming March, the plan would be in place and they would vote on the town would then vote on the plan. So that's the process. Summersworth is going through exactly that same process, except they're starting now, and they don't have to do a warrant article in front of people. They will be, they must have been on their ballot, are they on their ballot yesterday, 2 days ago? No, so it's not even on a town ballot.
No, they just had it, the city council just held the public hearing.
Okay.
And on December 3rd, it's going to be on their agenda for action.
Oh, so they don't have to go through the public at that point?
Correct.
Okay, all right. And then they would have a year, so they have a year from December.
Before the committee to explore it?
Yes.
Or to do it?
Explore it.
To explore it, okay.
I might suggest that for this, I think we need a separate meeting to just address this. To get everybody we need to discuss the options. I'm just afraid, you know, we can make a decision and say, yeah, let's just do this, but go ahead.
What we have to decide is whether we want to start the process. It doesn't mean that we will decide to withdraw, and we're not, we will not be deciding the options. And we can't even start discussing the options, some of which, because that's the committee's job to do that, if we decide to.
And let me take that one step further. You're not even going to be deciding on whether you start the process. You're deciding on whether you want to put the warrant article out there. Ultimately, the warrant article has to pass to start the process.
Right. In a way, we're trying to play catch up here a little bit to see, and we have a little bit of time so that we can discuss this.
Let me ask this question that ties into what you guys are talking about. To put a warrant article to explore the process of what we might do.
Yes.
Of withdrawing, of forming the committee.
What's the wording then? What's the wording on the warrant?
The warrant would be to create a committee to explore withdrawal from SAU 56.
Okay.
And then if that passes, you would create the committee. And then throughout, that would be in March of 19. And then the committee would be formed if it passes. And then the exploration and all the options and the outsourcing and the reduction and all of that would be found by the committee and presented back to the public. And then the following March, it would be March of 20, that it would be on the warrant to withdraw. And then again, the public would have the opportunity to.
Question, if the committee decides that they do not want to withdraw, do they put a warrant article on, or?
It's not up to the committee. The committee is charged with gathering all the information. So the committee will gather all the information, and these are your three options. And then the next warrant would decide to withdraw.
Well, who would decide whether to put that next warrant on the ballot?
Yeah, we've got to back up a little bit more. It's really very clear in the RSA, and that committee is actually going to, if you're going to go forward with the withdrawal, the committee is going to have a plan, a withdrawal plan. It's going to say, here's how we proceed. And it's also, if Summersworth decides to do it, they can't just do it on their own and not keep us informed. They have to keep us informed.
My question, okay. Mm-hmm. My question is, that second warrant article, yep. Who's responsible? The school board? So if we decide we don't like this plan, do we say, no, we don't want to put the warrant article on?
Well, don't forget, we will have two members on the committee. So
yeah, but I'm just saying,
three members disagree with those two members.
Go forward with a particular suggestion. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that's second warrant.
Well, this is, yeah, I mean, this is something, a plan is going to be brought up. We are going to have, the school board will have, plus the superintendent, so that's three members now of it, will have input into that plan. That plan has to be approved by the Secretary of Education or the Education Department, I'm not sure which.
Prior to going on the warrant?
Prior to going on the warrant, yes.
And then, so the board would then, we would then vote to put the warrant article on?
I think so, because it's, we are the only people who can, well, or it could be petitioned. Any of this could also start with a petition.
Of course, right.
Any of this could also start with a petition. Now, the plan has to pass, if indeed there, a plan is brought up, a plan has to pass by 3/5 of the voters that vote.
Oh, interesting.
Not just a majority vote. So, I mean, this is, again, we're playing catch-up, so it seems, we don't have to decide this evening, but we do have to keep, it's, but I also think that we should have these discussions with Summersworth at our next SAU board meeting. I think that, you know, I'm
Well, we should do that, because, you know, we have, you know, the last one, we had an attendance problem on their part, so, and I
True enough.
But, you know, I think that makes it a little bit difficult, because we have the majority of the folks at the last meeting, which we couldn't even have a meeting. We didn't have enough folks showing up, so this, if it's going to come down to a time issue, when we need to do this, we may just be off on our own.
Well, we will. We have to decide in time to whether or not put the warrant article on in March. That's, I think that's where we're at, and so we have to January. We have to January to figure that out.
I think we don't have any of a real option. I think we need to explore, and someone, we need to look at what our cost, what our best, you know, option is.
Right, and we can't do that until we start the process. There's no point in doing it until we have a
Go ahead and approve forming a committee, for sure. Because if you don't explore it, we won't have
Yeah, I just didn't know what we were what we were saying, what we were, you know, going forward.
Yeah, tonight is just to lay out that our first decision is to decide whether or not to put it in front of the public that we will form the committee and learn our options.
Right. Yes. Does doing that lock them into our time frame at all? Like,
no, you're going to have two time frames going on all at once. So they're going to be doing yours. They're going to be doing theirs. You're going to be doing yours separate from each other. Part of the charge of the committee, part of the charge of your committee looking at it, part of the charge of their committee ultimately when it gets submitted to the state, is you have to, in the plan, has to have what's the other entity going to do. So, you know, you're going to find out, the committee is going to find out what your options are and what are they going to do to make sure that they're in a place that's manageable. And they're going to committee is going to be doing the exact same thing.
I believe by statute they even have to hold public hearings here in Rollinsford. I believe so. I can't remember.
Yeah, it's set up,
we would have to have one in Summersworth.
It's set up to have some safeguards so one community doesn't just pull up and leave somebody else hanging. So.
That's what I was wondering. If they finish sooner, do they just get to pull out and then we're stuck for however many months?
The state's not going to allow that to happen.
So we can certainly not, well, we don't need to take a vote on it tonight on whether or not we want that warrant to go forward.
Yeah, you've got time.
It's unfortunate that it's come down to what it's come down to. I think we've been, you know, I thought I was enjoying a really collegial relationship with Board. I've enjoyed the work that we've done together. I think
I don't get the feeling it's the board.
Yeah. Well, that could be. But I do. We certainly Tom and I know, and some of the rest of you too, how seriously we take our one job that we do together, which is hiring and overseeing the superintendent. And we really take that very seriously, and we spent a lot of time last year. Anyway, we'll move forward as best we can and probably get this in front of our public. funding we might need for that before we finish up the budget, because we might need legal advice, we might need a number of things that we have to pay for, printing of documents and all sorts of things, plans. So, anyway, things that we need to think about for that. Any further questions or thoughts on that right now?
Yeah, I guess I'm trying to understand if both legally, you know, like we have contracts with you, contracts with both communities, I would think are still liable for, I mean, I guess if you're looking at the duration of the process.
That would be part of both the committees to look at, you know, what are the contractual obligations, if you will, what are the physical obligations, if there's a building involved or things like that. That's all part of what the committees need to look into.
Okay. Yeah, unfortunately, we'd like to start jumping into all the options, but we don't have any legal authority to start looking at those options. That's what the committee will have to do.
Right.
Any other thoughts, questions? All right, the FY20 budget discussion. So we're back on the budget discussion to finish some of this next year's budget.
Yes, we've already had our budget meeting earlier tonight. Is there anything
skip
else
this
that?
Yes. Yeah, I think we just put it on there in case we have extra things that we need.
Yeah, we pretty much got through there. And, you know, we still have to discuss warrants, obviously. One of the things I'd like us to keep in mind to see if we can start thinking about, it's not too early to start thinking about providing childcare, particularly for the deliberative session, which is going to be in an evening, Tuesday evening. And to think about that, maybe work with anyone in the school who's available, who might know people who might be available. We will pay. We're not going to do so many mailings, but we'll save money to volunteer my daughter. Start thinking about that and also we want them for the public hearing, the budget committee's public hearing as well. So we'll be on a Saturday. I believe Saturday is the 5th.
Community service.
Oh, darn, we should have mentioned this when Nick was still here.
Don't worry, we'll get the word out.
Anyway, just start thinking about it. Okay, good. All right, moving on. So the secure entrance project discussion. This is what Chris Solomon was here last month, whenever he was here last, talking about the secure entrance and what the next step would be on that. I think at this point we're down to deciding whether or not we want to go full steam ahead and think about putting a warrant article on for it, or slowing down, and or whatever. I don't know. We need to talk about what we want to do with that.
The grant for security that we got last year, is there any word on that being offered again this year?
At the present time, there's a little bit of money left. And it's from projects that were approved that either came through on the budget or didn't get final approval of the funding. So there's some money left. They're earmarking it for schools that have not received any of it yet. Will there be more in the future? I don't know. They would have to obviously come up with another large sum of money.
Right.
That open up the application. I haven't heard that there is or there isn't.
Okay, thank you.
The other thing that we could discuss is trying to determine if we want to somehow think about, I don't know what it would cost to go to the next step, but to bring on a construction engineer in talked about. So what we have now are two options in front of us, the least expensive, the most expensive. We know that, and we know there's one in between. I don't know what people want to proceed at this point with it. And we don't have to proceed at this point, it's just a matter of thinking about it.
So I need to see the pictures.
They're in here.
Yeah, some of the pictures are in here.
Oh, I didn't scroll down hard, thank you.
It is a considerable amount of money, it's something that I doubt that we would do simply as a warrant. I believe it would be something we have to think about bonding, and it's already late in the season to start thinking about that, I think, in terms of getting that out with all the public hearings that would have to be held and everything else through the holiday. And we're talking, the least expensive is $500,000. So, I mean,
you did say too that we could,
that's true,
nickel and dime it a little bit to take certain pieces out and get that number down. This was sort of a pie in the sky figure. But still, it's a considerable sum.
No, I'd be the first one to say let's do it. I just think it's too much right now. Even bond. You know, we've done such a good job with this budget over the last few years. And, you know, try to keep that on track. I just don't think the town has the appetite for it. At least right now.
Well, I'm concerned with our SAU issues.
Yeah, we've got, I mean, even though that thing is probably going to be a couple of years down the line, and we're not really sure, you know, how all that's going to pan out expense-wise, but yeah, I just think it's too rich. Rich.
I wonder if there's another option working with what we have now to simply make it more secure.
Yeah, what are, you know, I get it, you know, they did a great presentation, it looked great, there was some real benefits to it. If we had that kind of appetite to put the money into the school, I'd say, yeah, absolutely. And there were, I mean, what, four choices? There were four different options or three?
There were three.
But, you know, if there was something else that we could explore,
on a smaller scale.
On a much smaller scale. Then we should at least look into it. I don't know. Mm-hmm. It just seems like when I saw the presentation, I knew it wasn't going to be cheap, but I was worried that was even at all attainable. That's all. You know, what other options do we have right now?
Again, as far as future infrastructure money, that's anybody's guess right now, whether that's going to be an opportunity or not.
But we still have, I mean, either way, we still, I mean, what are our options just as a design option? What other things do we do? I'm sure there are other schools that are in the same boat. That's a lot of money.
Yeah, there are, and it's the infrastructure money, while on both the state and the national level, they talk about hardening schools or making them more secure, they don't necessarily put the money out there to help us do it. So we have to sort of see how that goes
about.
And the funds that we have been, or the emergency funds, and this is not, I guess, considered emergency.
It's not an emergency until it is, obviously. But also, the list from Dick, if we look at, I know that moving forward, I know we're looking at replacing boilers, and that's hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
And the heating system, the whole heating system and ventilation system is high on his list. So that there's good air and in the school and things like that. So there are many different safety issues. And the ones that affect our students every day are the ones that we probably have to focus on.
So why would we have the safest, most secure ice box?
It's a dilemma.
Well, I would make the recommendation now that we table it and maybe talk later on in another meeting about
Right, it has to be substantial. All right, all right. So we will move forward with that, but we'll all keep it down, of course. All right, so the warrant, the next up is warrant article discussion, and Katie also included in the binders a section on warrants with sort of generally suggested ideas of warrants that we've either had in the past or will be having. The normal ones, so we we're hoping to have a collective bargaining warrant, we don't know. But right now we're certainly hoping to have one, so that's Article 5 if we have one.
Six.
It would be Article 6 if
Article
we have one.
Article 5 is the budget.
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, I don't know why I didn't turn the page, sorry. Article 6. Article 7 was where she slated in if we wanted to do the safe, secure entrance and renovation. So at the moment, we will not be doing that decision. We will continue looking at that. Then it's building improvements.
That's to place money in that fund at the end of the year.
Yep, the fund balance. And then there's also in fund balance the Education Expendable Trust Fund.
That's the one you created last year.
That's the one we created last year with a dollar of Tom's money.
Right.
And and it is unfunded, but that...
No, it's not. It's a dollar.
I'm sorry, that's a dollar. It's unfunded to any extent that's useful. but it would allow us, if we choose to fund that, it would allow us not to put in contingency students. The whole point is to have a stop on putting money in the budget that we don't need to put in the budget if we have a funded
tuition
reserve, right. So I certainly think we should think about a sum to put in there. So we can think about that and we know what our tuition for next year is going to be. We know it's about $10,500, and we're right around there. So, I would probably start thinking of at least 20, maybe 25. I believe Katie handed out to us what we have in our current.
Yours are in your binder. I handed it to you because you picked up your
binder before.
Everybody else is in your binder. Also, the building fund, the audit was completed this week, so $75,000 will be going into that, which is not included on that sheet. So that's going to be transferred tomorrow.
Okay.
So add $75,000 to that.
So the two that I would think of putting into, as we can think about, and again, we don't have to decide that this evening, but we can talk about them, is building improvement. I believe we feel pretty comfortable where our special ed is at the moment. It's at $155,000. So I'm thinking we take that one off, but we put into the building improvement and the tuition reserve fund.
So the tuition reserve fund, you said between 20 and 25.
That's just a suggestion. We don't know what it's a suggestion.
You might want to have a discussion on where you would be comfortable with that tuition reserve being. Do you want five tuitions in there eventually?
Well,
do you want 10? So, you may not, let's say it's five tuitions, that's around,
because that money is going to stay in that fund. That's not disappearing at the end of the school.
Right, it's going to stay there. But
it's going to continue to build.
Yes.
Right.
So.
The building fund disappears.
No, the building fund is not. This is stayed.
That's the other one.
Yes. The building fund is, this is looking forward to having to replace the ventilation system and the system.
This is good planning because it really is. I think historically we tried to be forecast and put a budget for these things, having a rainy day fund, but that's really what it is in terms of tuition.
Absolutely.
Because we don't know how to do it.
We got burned that first year so badly that many of us are still twitching from it. So
five students moved in and they're still back out.
We had 15 students in.
We froze the budget, but what does that do? It only freezes this school.
That's right.
And it was not a happy thing to do. So, I mean, a good thought, where would we like to be? If it's five tuitions, we're going to be at 50,000 plus, but so if we start with half of that now, is that the right to start with?
I'm assuming probably them stays the same.
Right, you would adjust it down.
Yeah, we may be budgeting for five and end up it covers four.
Yeah, true.
I think it's smart, but we'll talk about it.
Yeah, so we'll figure out exact amounts, but I think you can take off special ed if it's still on there.
Do you want us to put any tentative numbers in these warrant articles or just leave them blank?
I'm going to start with 25,000.
It doesn't mean it's final yet, so.
It's not final yet. I mean, I like, because we know we have big ticket items and we'll look over Dick's, the list that Rich shared with us, but I again would probably recommend that we go with, again with 75,000 in the building and probably 25 in the tuition.
And again, it's only not if money.
It's only if we have the money, yeah.
Well, I would think, just as a suggestion, we go for the cost of three students. Whatever that comes out.
So more like 30,000.
Yeah.
And how does it allocate out if we have, you know, if we put 75 and 30 and we have 85,000?
It's whatever article is listed first. If that happens first, then that's what I thought.
It's the order that is in prioritized.
And it's listed as up to, so the rest would go into that second article.
And it doesn't look at the moment, since that we will be putting any other warrants on that cost money. At the moment, it sounds like we're not planning to do that. So like last year, we had the kindergarten annex.
So would we want to switch the order, say if we did of the tuition?
Yeah, we can decide that.
You know what I mean?
To be sure we have a tuition. To be sure we have a tuition. Or to be sure we'll.
I can do that the next draft if you want, and then you can decide which I want.
That's fine today.
I don't know which is more better.
Yeah, we'll think about that.
Kind of unfair.
It definitely is. All right, any other thoughts on warrants or? All right, this year's budget.
Well, since we didn't hear that yet, the first part that I talked about in the memo, Mary went over in the budget about the different format and kind of the health and dental residents and all that. So I'm going to continue that also with budget updates, so that way you can still see all the other lines and it won't be as summarized as it's been. So since the last update, we did, as we talked about, received our first billing from Marshwood. Pam went over the special ed section, I took the regular ed. So as of right now, we're seeing savings of just over $55,000. And that's due to the fact that, as Pam said, we were budgeting for all of those meetings and things like that, plus changes in students and services. So that's what we have right now. I did put some spreadsheets in there from the budget to actual. I'll update those month to month as we get them, so that way you can see if there's any fluctuations or changes. As well as the purchase orders and the encumbrances, because I've encumbered it as the first billing, so if it changes next month, then I'll update those encumbrances as we go. Along with that tuition, you're going to see a big decrease or savings in our out-of-district placements, just as you saw in the budget. It's happening in this current budget.
This year. Okay.
Yeah, so there's an overage, I think, in middle school, but a big savings in the high school, a net of about $189,000 savings. So we'll keep an eye on that.
Yes.
You know, we haven't received any of the bills yet for those out-of-district placements, so as soon as we do, you know, we'll update the bills and stuff like that. But right now, we're seeing that.
And that it helps give us an idea as we look at the warrants and what we want to do there.
And then I also did a couple of utilities, because we had talked about that. I took a five-year average of the expenditures, and like I said, I'll take a look at that, you know, every couple of months and see if there's any change in the utilization, and we can adjust that as we go. Release it if we need to, as the year goes on. And then you'll see we did receive the $50,000 reimbursement for well, it's not really a reimbursement, I guess this year it's other revenue, but we did receive it. And as I said, the auditors were in the office this week, so the audit is done. It went well. They did recommend that we review our fiscal policies every year.
What does that mean?
So in your policy book, you have policies that pertain to fiscal things, you know, financial items. And they recommend,
haven't paid too much attention.
So they recommend that you at least review them every year. So I talked to Lori, and she said that she was going to work with Bob about bringing them forward to the board so that we can review them.
Okay.
tomorrow that withdrawal from the $75,000 will go to the trust funds, yeah, and the $1, right, you have to send the $1, so.
You have the $1?
Yeah.
Tom has it.
So that will happen tomorrow, so those will, I'll adjust those once that happens, and bring you new copies for your budget, so you'll have them.
Can I just add, maybe $1 and 1 cent?
Yeah.
Maybe it is.
Yeah, I think 1 cent would be.
Well, maybe.
I received a check from my bank today for 2 cents.
Somebody else wanted to send it to you.
I really, I'm gonna go make up your pocket.
So that's all I have, if there's any questions.
Any questions on the current budget, it's still early in the year, things are still shaking out, so it's a.
Well, we did also look at special ed transportation, because that was one thing we had in encumber, so that is now reflected in there, so.
Yeah, I appreciate that, as much as can be, you know, as much as we feel comfortable in encumber.
Yeah.
So we did not talk about, I think we decided we would not put the Kubla on as a warrant, but again, let's keep that in mind too.
It is included in the budget.
It is included in the budget.
Yes.
That's right.
I would like to discuss having it as a warrant instead. Would it simply because it's a lot of money and it's, could be kind of a frivolous thing, it's cosmetic. I would just like to see what the town thinks, do they want to fix it, or do they not fix it? What I've been thinking about. I'm on the fence about it.
I mean, I think it's a good question. I will say that people who have graduated from this school 20 years ago, 30 years ago, stopped me at the transfer station and said, Kubla, when are you going to fix it?
Absolutely.
I mean, but, so will they put their money where their mouth is? It's an interesting question.
My understanding is that, you know, like, we've got chicken wire out there, holding it up, or, so is that? I don't know, is it gone beyond cosmetic fixing?
Yeah, I don't know.
My question now, you know what I mean?
I think it has.
I think the answer to that is yes, because when we got the second, quote, it was more structural work, so, you know, you're talking in the 20s now instead of 7,500. Paint's not gonna do it.
Unless it's really thick paint.
Thick paint.
So, I mean, is it a safety concern as well? I mean, things falling off and down?
I don't know, I'm just so disgusted with the whole thing.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't even know what to say.
But if we put it on, so if we did a warrant article, then we.
And it doesn't pass, then do we just.
Well, if it doesn't pass, what if it?
I mean, we can't.
We can't.
Well, you can't.
We can't fix it or if it doesn't pass, that's the problem.
Yeah.
We can't just go fix it, because the town lives in, well, fix it. We know how the town is.
Okay, but if it does pass, and then we can go ahead and fix it in spring, or in summer.
In the summer.
It would be for next year.
Yeah, after July 1st.
However, if we left it in the budget, still next year's budget, sorry.
I was gonna say.
Unless you have.
Unless you have.
Unless we have unexpended funds, then we could. And I think that's, our last discussion was, we would revisit it in February, March, if it looks like we're having unexpended funds, and then, and use it for that. Because I was so involved in the process that helped the school become an historical landmark, I feel it would be, that it's in our best interest to repair it, to its, not maybe its former glory, but at least something that looks good. I think it's either that or remove it, essentially. And to remove it really is
Do you lose any of your historical status if you remove it?
No, we can do anything with the building that we want to. It means that we might not be eligible for certain funds. We do not lose the historical status.
To me, from a priority standpoint, I think unexpended funds should go towards safety things that we're trying to catch up with. Mm-hmm. Just my opinion. It's just a lot of money to fix the Kubla. Maybe, you know, in the meantime, we get another quote that's
I think it's it's an interesting thought to do it as a warrant article, I think, just to see, you know, we have heard, you know, there has been a lot of noise about wanting it fixed, and maybe it is a good time to see what the public wants to do. So we won't make a decision on the, because we're not finishing up the warrants, but let's continue to give it some thought, and we'll discuss it again. Okay, a little bit of time for that. Anything else on the current year's budget, the 18-19 budget? Emily, an update on the last budget committee meeting?
Not much to say. We've got lots of hearings scheduled for the next few weeks. Our presentation is the day before our next board meeting, which is what, the 8th?
No.
It's the 13th.
13th.
So it's the 12th. So 12th. But this is the 8th.
Yeah. Yes.
Next month is the 13th.
Yes. Thank you. December.
So the 12th is the budget committee presentation for next year's budget.
And that will be here, I believe.
It does say Rollinsford Grade School Gym on your agenda, so.
Are you okay with that? Wednesday?
Always has been.
I know, I'm checking with the principal, who doesn't know that.
Put it on the.
Okay. And part of the reason for that is if technology is needed, it may not be needed for this first meeting, but it will be when we do the public hearing, so.
The one other thing that I think relates to the school to some extent is there are some concerns about the water pipes on Wiley that go under the, at the low building. That go through the low point and corrosion and the water quality and flow through those pipes because they're so old and there's so much corrosion in them. I know that the water is tested in the school regularly and we also have the filters, but just to bring it to the attention of anyone who is aware.
This fall, actually this summer and fall, there's been a number of times where they've been doing work and then once it's flushed, it turns brown for a period of time and then it flushes itself out. You know, the testing has come back that it's drinkable once it's tested, but it's flushing it through. Tomorrow, it's being shut off for a couple of hours for a replacement of some item. Just got to make us aware during the day when that's going to happen. Fortunately, we don't have students tomorrow, we have staff. But yeah, it's been a number of times this year. A couple of times in the summer, our rec program was concerned about dismissing children because we didn't have any water. They've been very good. The water district's been very good about communicating and, you know, letting us know that, you know, that they're working.
They are working really hard on it, and they have gotten quotes that are quite expensive for their solutions to the problem, and are looking for kind of more efficient, less expensive ways of seeing what the true problems are and fixing them. So they're working hard on it, but it's just something we should be aware of.
Any new business to come before the board? Old business, it looks like we've been through pretty much all the old business. And I don't believe we have any action items left to do with at the moment. Future meetings, we do have the SAU board meeting on the 19th at Mulligan's Grill. Here's hoping that we actually have a quorum for that. And then the budget committee on the 12th. Our meeting on the 13th of December, and we'll move on from there. Then the whole budget cycle, we have a separate.
I will be emailing you two next week to pick up your SAU budgets.
Yes, thank you. Oh, yes.
Budget for the 19th meeting, so be on the lookout for
okay.
That. Okay. No, it got, the 12th is a holiday, and it got moved to the 13th.
Got it. Thank you.
That's right. One thing I think that I think needs to be clear, I think on our budget timeline, which I know is here somewhere, it's in your budget by the way, more on their deliberative session. So I believe that our public hearing is January 5th.
Oh, it's not on here.
No, it's the 12th on here.
Oh.
Correct, Emily? Ours is going to be the 5th, and the town is going to go the 12th. And that's the budget committee's public hearing.
Okay.
Either way, there was a meeting on the 5th and a meeting on the 12th, and both are held here at the school, I believe.
So we're the 5th?
I believe so. Emily, is that?
Just
correct. I got the budget. I just want to make sure that
January 5th is what?
January 5th.
It's Saturday.
No.
No, that was the deliberative session.
Oh, you mean December 5th?
No.
January.
January 5th. Scheduled on the 5th.
Okay.
And at 9 a.m. here, and that the town budget committee public hearing is on the 12th.
Do you want me to add that on here too?
Also
the town one?
January 12th.
January 12th. No, ours can stay ours, but okay. I'm kind of letting Rich know.
Okay. Yeah.
But,
so does that make the snow date is on here as January 15th? Is that still right? Or is that a different day then?
That's not a do they have snow days for those?
I don't know. It was always on here, so I put it on again.
Oh, no, the snow day is the 8th.
Okay.
And then the 8th for us, and then the 15th for the town.
Okay, perfect. I just had the
sorry. I'm not used to seeing snow days. I'm sorry. So that's, Emily, that's
show up on the snow day. We're going to show up on
I'm looking at this, so is that, I just want to make sure that everyone here. We did have it as the 12th.
Well, I know, that's why some of us didn't get it in the calendar because it was all draft and we were still
yes. So that's it. Any other school events? You had a nice list on yours, on your handout. That was good. Thank you, Rich, for that. All right, I think we're ready for closing comments. Visitors. Quiet visitors. No visitors. Closing comments by the board.